And the word of God says in 2 Timothy
3,
as we are soldiers that have been chosen by God, these soldiers, they don't entangle themselves in the affairs of the world because they are soldiers. We thank the Lord tonight that we are soldiers that have their armor on. We shall go to the word of God in the book of James chapter 4 verse 8. And that is where we find our topic for tonight. Draw near to God, and He will draw near to you. That is the topic. You draw near to God, and God will draw near to you. You do your part, and God will do His part. When you draw closer to God, He will also draw closer to you. But there is a challenge that the Lord Jesus Christ says. Most of the time, when people come to Him, or when they come to God, it's because they are seeking certain things. They cry unto Him, looking for whatever they are in need of. Now the challenge comes when they have received what they wanted, or when they are now happy, when things are now going well for them. They do not want to be nearer to God, because now all is well with them. Whatever they've been crying to God for, they've received it. The only thing they know, when they have to draw near to God, is when they need something. And God, being a wonderful God, a gracious God, a faithful Father, according to His word of Matthew 7:7, ask and you shall receive. And because they have asked, they receive. But once they have received, they don't want anything to do with God. They've got what they wanted. They're interested in the blessings more than the blesser. In the word of God, in Luke chapter 17, from verse 11 to 18, we are reminded here of 10 lepers that called unto Jesus as He was on His way to Jerusalem. Now He went past Samaria and Galilee. There were these 10 lepers who cried and called out to Him, because they knew they had something that they wanted. And they cry out to the Lord Jesus, Jesus, have mercy on us. And that is the cry we all make when we are faced with so many challenges, and when we want things from God. We say, Lord Jesus, have mercy on us, because He is a merciful God. The word of God says, when He saw them, He just said to them, go and show yourselves to the priests. And as the word of God continues, it says, as they were on their way, as they went, they were cleansed. They were on their way, because Jesus said, go and show yourselves to the priests, because that is what the law required at that time. Now as they went, they were cleansed from their leprosy. It takes a person
who does not only want blessings,
you are saying you would
but also the blesser,
you
who realize the change.
You are
the word of God says, as they were going, only one of them saw that he was healed. Out of the 10, only one realized that I am healed. Even before he got to the priests, the word of God says, he turned back. He went back to the one who said, go and show yourselves to the priests. But on their way, this one realizes that, but I am healed now. And he went back and glorified God. The Bible says he gave thanks to him. And what drew my attention was, this man was a Samaritan. And Jesus asked a question. Were you not 10? Where are the others? How many times has God blessed you? And how many times did you come back to him and say, Lord, I thank you? Can you really count your blessings right now? If you can count your blessings, in all of those blessings, did you come back to God and say, Lord, I thank you? You woke up this morning. You are still breathing. Did you say, Lord, I thank you? Or you just switched off your alarm because you believe that it was your alarm that woke you up. God allowed you to wake up today. It was not because you set the alarm. Because the alarm would have rang. But your soul would not be there. Your spirit would not be there. And the alarm will continue. Draw near to God. And he will draw near to you. Don't just come to him because there are certain things that you want. Come to God. Draw near to him. Even when there is nothing that you want from him. But just so that you get closer to him. So that you get to know him better. Most people, often they want to be healed. And they've had the grace in this place. And they come here because they want healing. They've had the grace of jobs in this place. They come here because they want jobs. The grace of deliverance. They come here because they want to be delivered. We also have the grace of marriages in this place. They come because they are in search. Not because they want the one who gave us the grace. The one who can heal. They don't want the healer. They just want healing. And once they've got that healing, they go away. Once they've received their job, they go away. Because when they come back, we will tell them of paying tithe. And paying tithe means some of the money must leave them. And that is not what they want. All they want is the blessing. They just want to be blessed. But what surprises is, as much as they want healing, they don't care about what caused the sickness in the first place. They're not concerned about that. They just want to be healed. They want to be blessed. They don't want to know. And they don't care what made them not to be blessed. Because God wants us all to be blessed. But if you believe you are not blessed, maybe it's time you find out why am I not blessed. You want healing. You want to be blessed. You want deliverance. Whatever blessings that you want, The Bible says in Exodus chapter 15, verse 26.
Exodus chapter 15, verse 26.
You see, I love the word of God when it says, if, not when, if you diligently need the voice of the Lord your God and do what is right in his sight, give ear to his commandments and keep all his statutes, I will put none of the diseases on you which I have brought on the Egyptians, for I am the Lord your healer. Praise the Lord. Amen. You want to be healed. You want to be blessed. You must diligently heed the voice of the Lord. It's not just about you getting the blessings and the healing. But it is about you doing what is right before God. According to his word. You listen to his commandments. And you hear them. And you do them. And you live them. And you keep all his statutes, everything that he said. Once you do that, he says, I will put none of the diseases on which I have brought on to the Egyptians. So what is important here, child of God, is that every word that you have heard being preached, you must not just be the hearers of the word, but be the doers of the word. Don't just hear it and be excited that you've heard the word of God. But you must do what the word of God says. If the word of God says, we must be united, then we must be united. If there are some people that you still don't talk to, you must make effort that you talk to those people. Even if it was not you who did what was wrong, but you take it upon yourself and we follow on our master's footsteps. When he was crucified on the cross, he said, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. You must go and ask for forgiveness. You will not lose anything. You are doing that because you want to live the word. And because you want to be blessed. Blessings, it's not about you alone. It is how you commune with the other brethren. Because remember, you shall be blessed so that you bless others. It is not just about you. That is why you don't receive the blessings you want. Because God looks at the heart. There is nothing that has to do with anyone else in your heart except yourself. Not even God is not there. It's just you. Do you want to know what caused that sickness and made you not to be blessed? I know there are so many different reasons. And the biggest reason that we always give is that it's an attack from the devil. That's the most important one that we always say. But I found something in the word of God. And it also starts by saying, if. In the book of 2 Chronicles, chapter 7, verse 14. If my people, who are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, once they do all these things, the word of God says, God says, then I will hear. Maybe you've been praying for so long, but you haven't done these four things. You are not humble. You are just not humble. And God says, if you can humble yourself,
You will receive what you want. Just humble yourself. Make a decision that I will humble myself. And not only will I humble myself, I will pray. Humility is needed from us. Humility is what God desires. Not to know yourself, because everything will be about you. Humble yourself. Once you've humbled yourself and you have prayed, God says, seek my face. You need to seek God's face. The problem with us as human beings, we seek God's face. But on the other hand, we are seeking other faces. We are putting God on a scale with other gods. And you say, whichever comes first to rescue me in my situation, then I will follow that one. Seek God's face and Him alone. And then you turn from your wicked ways. Turn from your wicked ways. There are ways that are wicked. And you know they are wicked. You see, we all come here every time. We don't even know how wicked you are. But we pray together. We call the fire together. And you know very well that you are wicked. When you get out of here, that is when people will see how wicked you are. And you will even say, my God. Just let them do something to me. Just let them do it. And they will see what I'm made of. We thought you were made of the blood of Jesus. And by the fire of God. And by the Spirit of God. And you begin to wonder, what is it exactly that we shall see? Let them just do it. They will see what I'm made of. They will see who I really am. And indeed, we would love to see, who are you? Because you may be a wolf in a sheepskin. When a person draws near to God, it is your responsibility that you must investigate and find out what is it that made you to be in that situation. You know, there are situations where we put ourselves in them because we did not trust God enough. And because we confessed negative things. Because there is power in your tongue. That is why it is important for you and me that we must first investigate and find out what put me into this situation. Many times we say it's the devil. And wherever he is, he must not be happy that I'm speaking on his behalf. Because there are times where we'll just say it's the devil when it's not the devil. It's because of the words that we spoke. We confessed wrong things. And because we confessed wrong things, then he got hold of that. And he used it. Because remember, the word of God says, he is prowling around like a roaring lion, looking for whoever he can devour. Now there you are, you speak negative things. And then he says, aha, I got you. You invited the devil because of what you spoke. And then you are in this situation. Once you have acknowledged your wrongs before God, You acknowledge your wrongs. It's important that you repent. Then you go ahead and ask God. Because I can tell you one thing. If you read the word of God, there is a whole list of all the wrongs that the children of Israel did. And the problem started when they left Egypt. If you read the word of God, it says as they left Egypt, there are also a mixed people that came along with them. I'm not sure what other mixed things you are involved in. Because those are the things that will take you out of the way of God. Immediately when they are taken out of Egypt, they started complaining. These people, they started crying unto God. They want to be free. They want to be set free. They want to get out of this slavery. And God heard in heaven. And he said, I have heard the cry of my people. Therefore, I have come down so that I rescue them. Because I love them. They are my people. Now God has come down and he is using Moses to take them out of Egypt. On the very first account, the word of God says, it records that when Moses and Aaron went to Pharaoh and told him that God says, let my people go. After that first encounter, Pharaoh said, okay. Now I'm going to double their work. And because Pharaoh had doubled their work, the Israelites started complaining. And I'm like, these people, it means complaining was in them. It has become part of their life because of the place that they are living in. They called unto God and God has answered their prayers. But because they are used to these surroundings, they are still complaining. Even when God took them out, and they are faced with the Red Sea in front of them, mountains on the sides, and there is the enemy behind. The first thing they say, were there no graves in Egypt that you wanted to us to come and die here? The Israelites were not obedient. And God said, he gave them the Ten Commandments. Worship no any other God except me, for I am a jealous God. But they refused to walk in his law. They forgot all the works and the wonders that he did. They rebelled against God. They tested God. They spoke against God. They did not believe in God or trust in his salvation. The word of God says, once you acknowledge your wrongs, then you must repent. Because going back to those wrongs, it makes you to be very far from God. The Israelites wanted to go back to Egypt. Now in Egypt, they were not worshipping God alone. In Egypt, they were worshipping other gods. And now they had seen what the Egyptians were worshipping. And God, that is why he said, I must take them out, so that they come and worship me as their God. Now if you decide to go back to slavery, it will bring back the sicknesses and all these other challenges. Now, if you ask for mercy and forgiveness from God, your heart must be very repenting from what you were doing. When David said in Psalms 51, verses 3 and 4, David said, I acknowledge my transgressions. That is what he said. He said, I acknowledge. And he says, my sin is always before me. Because I know what I've done. And I have sinned against you. And you only. And done what is evil in your sight. When you are healed and you have received what you were asking for from God, do not go back. Because the moment you go back, God will move away from you. I want to read the word of God in the book of Deuteronomy chapter 8. From verse 11 to
19.
It's a wonderful scripture. It says, beware that you do not forget the Lord your God by not keeping his commandments, his judgments, and his statutes, which I command you today. Lest when you have eaten and are full and have built beautiful houses and dwell in them, and when your herds and your flocks multiply, and your silver and gold are multiplied, and all that you have is multiplied, when your heart is lifted up, and you forget the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, from the house of bondage, who led you through that great and terrible wilderness, in which were fiery serpents and scorpions and thirsty land where there was no water, who brought water for you out of the flinty rock, who fed you in the wilderness with manna, which your fathers did not know, that he might humble you and that he might test you to do you good in the end. Then you say in your heart, my power and my might and my hand have gained me this wealth. And you shall remember the Lord your God. For it is he who gives you the power to get wealth, that he may establish his covenant, which he swore to your fathers, as it is this day. Then it shall be, if you by any means forget the Lord your God, and follow other gods, and serve them, and worship them, I testify against you this day, that you shall surely perish. That is the word of God. The word of God says, when everything is now going well with you and your stomach is now full, your stomach is full, that is why you are no longer drawing near to God. Because your stomach is full and your bank account is well, you lack nothing. And then you begin to boast. And you say, it is my power. It's my strength. I got this wealth because of my wisdom. Because I'm able to do these things. And there is no one like me. And you forgot that you cried in the first place. And you said, Lord, have mercy on me. Bless me, Lord. And he blessed you. And you in turn, now you say it is because of your own power. God says, I testify against you this day. You shall surely perish. Because you have forgotten God. You have forgotten where these blessings come from. Draw near to God. And God will draw near to you. Let me tell you what happens in the word of God. In the book of Luke chapter 11 verse 24. To 26. It says, when an unclean spirit goes out of a man, he goes through dry places, seeking rest and finding none. Then the evil spirit says, I will return to my house from which I came. And when he comes, he finds it swept and put in order. Then he goes and takes with him seven other spirits, more wicked than himself. And they enter and dwell there. And the Bible says the last state of that man is worse than the first. Because if you are not going to draw near to God, now you have received your healing. Instead of you maintaining the healing by reading the word of God, by praying, by seeking his face, and turning from wicked ways, now the house is clean. Your heart is now clean. But the evil spirits that were removed from your heart, they are wandering around about. And because the devil is such a boring thing, he has nothing else to do than to wander about. And that is why even the demons do the same thing. When they are cast out, they move around, still wanting a place to stay. And the demons have even the audacity to say, I will go back to my house. How can demons be so full of authority and say, I will go back to my house? Which house? Because if you draw near to God, God will draw near to you. And my Bible tells me that our God is a consuming fire. So there should be no demon coming back to his house. Don't you know that you are the temple of the Lord? Not temple of demons. You keep that house clean by drawing closer to God, by reading the word of God and praying, seeking his face, and you obey his commandments, you leave his word, then there is no demon that is going to claim your body as their house. You see, there are challenges in life that when they come and you investigate and you find out what is it that you did and you don't find anything wrong, then you will know that these are persecutions that are coming to me as a child of God. Then you begin to say the word of God that is in the book of James chapter 1. You count it all joy because you know that these testings and these tribulations, they are coming to test your faith. They are coming to strengthen you. And once you are strengthened, you will lack nothing. Not because you are not closer to God. You are closer to God. You are drawn nearer to God. And God is near to you. But there are still these challenges. You are going through an examination that you must pass. They are strengthening your faith. It is not time for you to go back. It is time for you to draw even closer to God. You don't go away from God because of the challenges that you are facing. Those challenges that you are facing should bring you even closer to God, because God is doing something in your life. There is something that God is making out of your life, because he is building this gold out of you. And because you want to be this gold in the hands of God, you need to go through the fire. And that is why he says in his way, even when you go through the fire, I am right there with you. It's just that I'm building something out of you. Allow me to build it in you. All you need to do is to draw closer to me. Yeah. those challenges should not make you to run away from God or make you go back. For if the word of God says in 2 Peter chapter 2 from verse 20, for if after they have escaped the pollutions of the world through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, they are again entangled in them and overcome, the latter end is worse for them than the beginning. For it would have been better, it would have been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness, than having known it, then turn from the holy commandment delivered to them. But it has happened to them according to the true proverb, a dog returns to his own vomit, and a sow having washed to a wallowing in the mire. The word of God says, once you have been enlightened and you know the truth, if you decide to go back and you entangle yourself in all these pollutions that you were taken out from, the Bible says, you shall be worse from the beginning. And it says it would have been better that you never heard about this grace. It would have been much better. You are in the grace where you can even ask Jesus Christ, what is this in my life? You have investigated, you still cannot find it. You are in the grace of asking Jesus Christ himself, what is it that I'm not doing right? What is this? But instead of you writing and asking, you decide to go back to the pollutions of the earth. The Bible says that proverb is true about you. And take note of this. The word of God says, a dog returns to his own vomit. I stopped for a while here when I saw this word. I'm expecting the word to say a dog returns to its own vomit. But the dog here is personified. A dog returns to his own vomit. You were delivered, child of God. And you vomited every rubbish of darkness in your life. You were cleaned by the blood of Jesus Christ. And by the fire. And because now things are not going well with you, because you are going through the fire. Yeah, the word of God says, even though I walk through, you are walking through. What makes you think you are staying there? You are not staying there. You are walking through where you are going. The road or the path, it requires you to pass through this one. But it doesn't mean that when you are passing through that, then that is where you are going. That is not where you are going. There is somewhere where Jesus said you are going. But because you don't want to draw closer to him, you think, because I'm here, it means this is the end. I'm finished. Who told you are finished? Is this how you look when you are finished? You say you are finished, but you are still complete. You are passing through. You are not remaining there. It is not meant for you to stay there forever. And there is no other way around. You must pass through this. And that is why he says, when you pass through, I will be with you. Because passing through situations is not easy. It needs you and me to draw closer to God. Then I will understand that I am just passing through. Why have you parked? That is not where Jesus said you are going. Start that car and start moving. Is it because you were afraid that dogs were barking at you? Dogs do not bark at a stationary car. If you are a stationary car, what dogs do, they lie underneath and find rest. Because it's a stationary car. It's not moving. But the moment you get inside that car and you start the ignition, that dog will run away. Don't stay in that place. It is not meant for you. You are just passing through, child of God. Whilst you are in that situation, draw closer to God. Draw even closer to Him. He is faithful. He who has promised is faithful. He said, I will be with you until the end of time. Who told you that is the end? Did Jesus say that this is the end? Right there where you are. Draw close to Him. And you will see the end. Do not be like the children of Israel. When they got to the land of Canaan, the Bible says they refused to enter. Hey. They refused to enter. God said, I am taking you to a land full of milk and honey, flowing with milk and honey. Now they are in that land. They don't want to go in because they are seeing giants. And they forgot that the one who said, I am taking you to that land, is still the same God who took them out of Egypt and opened the Red Sea for them. You know what God has done for you in your life. You know better. You know what makes you to forget the promises of God now? What do you think will make God to be a different God now? Because my Bible tells me He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. If He took you out of that situation, He can still take you out of this one. Just draw closer to Him. It's only Joshua and Caleb that said, no, let's go in. God said, we shall take this land. So we are going in. You must have that Caleb spirit, that Joshua spirit, that I don't care what other people are saying. I don't care what they are saying right now, but I am going in and I am taking it over. Because that is what God said to me. And I'm holding Him by His word. He says, if I draw close to Him, He will draw close to me. And this is the promise He gave me. Now there is some kind of a devil that wants me to get away from my promise. I know my God. My God is a consuming fire. He's going to consume all this rubbish. And I'm going to take my blessing. I am going to take what God has promised me, because it belongs to me. I cannot share it with the devil. Just draw closer to Him, and He will draw closer to you. The more you draw closer to Him, the Bible says, eye has not seen, And no ear has heard what the Lord has prepared for you. You think you've seen blessings? That is nothing. That's nothing. Are you so comfortable in that blessing you think that's the end? You haven't seen anything. Just keep on getting closer to him. You'll see something you've never seen before in your life. And they will ask, how come? And you will say, my God, my Jesus, who is faithful. I love him when he says, he will fight my battles. All I need to do is to be still and allow him to fight my battles. While I am still, I worship him. I give him the glory. I say, Father, you are worthy. You are Jehovah. There is no one like you. You are Jehovah Jireh. You are Jehovah Rapha. You are Jehovah Tsikenu. You are worthy of all praise and honor. The Bible says, when Jehoshaphat and the children of Judah were praying and worshiping God, God was finishing the enemy down there. There is power in worship.